Good morning and welcome to St. John's Cathedral. If you're a guest with us today, we are pleased to have you with us. You are important to us, and so we hope you will participate in our worship today. Join us at the altar rail for communion. If you are younger, or if you're a grandparent and have your grandchild with you or your child with you, we have skip church for the children, and they follow the crucifer and they follow the procession and go downstairs. It's lively, it's Christian education and a great experience. And if your child needs your presence, take their child down and you might leave them or come and then come back and join us at the altar and come back and join us at worship. So please don't stay lost. If we can help you find your way this morning, please ask one of us. We'd be glad to do that. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And
thank you.
Almighty God, to you our hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, because without you we are not able to please you, mercifully grant that your Holy Spirit may in all things direct and rule our hearts. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated.
James reflects on the paradox that such a small part of our bodies, the tongue, can cause so much damage. A reading from the letter of James. Not many of you should become teachers, my brothers and sisters, for you know that we who teach will be judged with greater strictness. For all of us make many mistakes. Anyone who makes no mistakes in speaking is perfect, able to keep the whole body in check with a bridle. If we put bits into the mouths of horses to make them obey us, we guide their whole bodies. Or look at ships. Though they are so large that it takes strong winds to drive them, yet they are guided by a very small rudder wherever the will of the pilot directs. So also the tongue is a small member, yet it boasts of great exploits. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I will walk in the presence of the Lord all my life. I will dwell in the land of the living. I will walk in the presence of the Lord all my life. I will dwell in the land. I love the Lord because he has heard the voice of my supplication, because he has inclined his ear to me whenever I called upon him. The cords of death entangled me, the grip of the grave took hold of me. I came to grief and sorrow. I will walk in the presence of the Lord all my life. I will dwell in the land of the living. Then I called upon the name of the Lord. O Lord, I pray you, save my life. Gracious is the Lord and righteous. Our God is full of compassion. I will walk in the presence of the Lord all my life. I will dwell in the land of the living. The Lord watches over the innocent. I was brought very low, and he helped me. Turn again to your rest, O my soul, for the Lord has treated you well. For you have rescued my life from death, my eyes from tears, and my feet from stumbling. I will walk in the presence of the Lord all my life. I will dwell in the land of the living.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark. He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." The Gospel of the Lord.
I speak to you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Please be seated. So earlier today, we already had a wailing morning service for last night's game in the chapel, so you missed it. But we've already gotten that out, so I'm glad you're here. And I want to make sure you caught something. Today, we're emphasizing Green Magnet, and especially the reading program. We've been partnered with Green Magnet for over a year now, and we're doing a lot of things over there. One of the things we're doing, though, is parishioners get trained, signed up to go read to the kids, and it's a very important ministry that a lot of you are taking part in. And first of all, thank you for doing it. We had a training earlier, and we're having a training after this service down in the Haslam room. And there's childcare if you have kids. I mean, we've taken care of that. So please, if you're interested, come down. It's great stuff reading to kids. And one of the stats they gave was that this school, which is about a mile away from us, just a mile, like less than 25% are on reading level. Okay? So just let that sink in. Less than 25%. This is important stuff. We need to get these kids to read so that they can graduate, so that they have options in lives. It's a great opportunity for us as well as our kids. But then what I want you to hear, though, is that the letter of James, how it began, not many of you should be teachers. Not many of you should be teachers. Great message for today. So anyway, just ignore that today. I'm not messing with that. We're going to go with the gospel, okay? So I want you to be teachers. Jesus said, if any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. Now, we in the Episcopal Church are not literalists, so I don't think Jesus is telling us that we have to literally pick up a cross and follow him. Regardless of that last sentence that the gospel has, I refuse to believe that this is just about getting into heaven. No, this is about our daily lives. It's about our daily lives, what it takes to follow Jesus, right here, right now. See, I think Jesus is telling us that following him means sharing in his life. Sharing in his life. We are called to share in the life of Jesus Christ. And as Jesus says, this implies that some of following Jesus is not easy. Sometimes following Jesus means it's going to cost you. See, there's something about this question. It implies a cost. Do you get the whole losing your life language? Following Jesus costs us something. I think that's something we learn along the way. We have to learn about cost. We have to learn about what things cost. Have you ever tried to explain to kids what things cost? They don't get it. You have to teach them. If our car breaks down, I have to talk about how we have to pay to get it fixed to my boys. And their response is, let's just go buy a new one. Okay? I'm telling you, you have to learn about how things cost. In fact, my wife saw this thing on Facebook about how you put chores on a clip, this board, and you have these clips, and they have the chores listed with dollar amounts, like 50 cents or a dollar, trying to teach them that if they want to buy something, they got to go do this, and then they get the money and they can save it. Some way that we can teach them. Now, I don't know if we'll really do it, because then we have to go get the clips and all that, but it's a good idea. We have to learn that following Jesus costs us too. We have to learn that. Now, hear me clearly. I'm not talking about earning God's love. I'm not talking about that. God's love is free. Grace abounds. There's nothing you can do or not do, say or not say, that will separate you from the love of God. That's a fundamental Christian truth. God loves you, period. And maybe that is where you are in your spiritual journey right now. Maybe that's where you need to be right now. Some people just need to know that God loves them. God's love is free. Thanks be to God. But that's not what this is about. This is about, Jesus is talking about something a little different here. If you want to follow Jesus, it's going to cost you. It doesn't have anything to do with getting into heaven. It has to do with following Jesus right now. There's no way around it. So what does Jesus cost you? What does Jesus cost you? What are you willing to pay? Do you really want to follow him? Now here's the weird thing. It's sort of paradox here. When we share in the life of Jesus, when we follow him, that stuff that costs us, it actually ends up blessing us in wonderful ways. The stuff that costs us actually ends up blessing us in wonderful ways. Have you ever experienced this? It happens simple ways. Ways that you've experienced whenever you follow Jesus. Me and my two older sons, we experienced it last month when we were helping out at Green Magnet, cleaning up the grounds, making it look nice. Didn't have to do it. We took our time, went over there, and helped out. And when we got done, you had this feeling of, satisfaction. It filled me full of life. I don't know how else to say it. It fills you full of life. Or another example, when you take the time to listen to someone who's hurting, listening to them, empathizing with them, and letting them know they're not alone, that you actually care about their loss. Again, you feel more full of life. You know what I'm talking about? You feel more full of life. All of those little moments that cost you time, energy, and emotions, all of them are somehow turned into life-giving moments. Life-giving moments. As Jesus says, those who lose their life will save it. And we have the ability to do it every day, in every situation, giving of ourselves and receiving more life for it. This is following Jesus. It's following Jesus. It's sharing in his life, and it's good. It's really good stuff. It gives our lives fulfillment. It connects us at a deeper level. It gets you out of your pity parties. You get connected. It's all good stuff. So, why wouldn't you want to share it? Why wouldn't you want to share it? And not in an aggressive, judgmental, in-your-face way, but in a loving, I've got something great that I want to share with you way. I mean, we do this all the time, right? If it's a good restaurant, we say, hey, I went to the best restaurant, blah, blah, blah. Or if you got a boat and you're out on the water, hey, come on out. Come on out. You want to share the good stuff, right? When my oldest Bill, when he gets ice cream, he gets real excited. Okay, he gets real, I mean, it's ice cream. It's pretty fun stuff. I got it. But he gets really excited. And he has this thing, he kind of jumps up and down when he gets real excited. He jumps up and down. He's always jumping up and down. Yeah, he's happy. And then he takes his first bite of ice cream. And the first thing he does, he always says how great it is. Oh, it's awesome. It's awesome. This is the best ice cream there is. And then the thing that he does right after that is he's like, taste it. Taste it. You get it? He wants to share it. He wants to share it. I usually say something like, that's okay, Bill. I know what mint chocolate chip tastes like. Go ahead, enjoy it. But he's persistent. Taste it. Taste it. And I see for myself, and I usually go, yeah, that's good. It's good ice cream. It's good ice cream. Makes him happy to share it. Sharing what is good. See, I have to teach my kids about what things cost, but I usually end up being taught by them about how to share. About 3.5 years ago, I was finishing up seminary at Suwannee, and I got a call from the bishop. He told me that he had talked with John and that they had agreed that I'd be appointed here. Well, I'd only been to St. John's one other time, and that was for the election of the bishop, so I decided to come up and sort of anonymously sit in and see how the worship was. So I drove up. I didn't go to 8 o'clock. I went to 10:30. I wouldn't get up that early. I got up here, and I sat back somewhere where, you know, Miss Jenny usually sits, right around there. In fact, I think I was right behind her. And the first thing I noticed when I got here was everybody was talking. Everybody was talking. That's not normal in most Fistful churches, and I liked it right away. People were happy to see each other. They were talking, catching up. I never really experienced that in the Episcopal Church. I liked it. It felt alive. And then I noticed there are families here. Again, not my experience in a lot of Episcopal churches. And people didn't mind the kids. In fact, they liked the kids. The kids processed in. Get it? People were laughing, smiling. Wow. It's a good place. It's very inviting. Very inviting. And the message was positive. It was not some theoretical, theological, academia argument that had nothing to do with real life. It was about real life. They can go on and on. St. John's is different. And I'm not putting other churches down. I'm sure this place doesn't appeal to everyone, but man, it worked for me. It still works for me. So if you feel that way about St. John's, I invite you to share it. See, John talked about the E word. And if you don't know, for Episcopalians, the E word last week, this is what he talked about, is evangelism. We had a joke about it at that training earlier. They were saying, they said in the training, you can't evangelize to these kids. And we all went, ha, ha. We're not, don't worry about that. Don't have to worry about that. Evangelism. Last week, John asked you to decide if there was someone you might consider inviting to church. Well, I want to continue with that thought. And so the office staff worked very hard this past week and made it as easy and convenient for you as possible. So as you leave today, in the back, the ushers and at the doors, they all have these bags. Now, they're similar to the bags that Dave and Charles always give out for our visitors that come here. But we tweaked it a little bit. Instead of just saying, welcome, we're glad you're here to St. John's, we're inviting you to come to St. John's. And it's got the information about St. John's. It's got all the literature. It's got the cookies. Yes, over 500-600 cookies were made this week. And if you don't feel, see, what I want you to do, I want you to go out, whoever you had in mind, and go give them this bag. Invite somebody to church. It's a simple thing. And it might start a conversation about why you like St. John's. It's got the information, where we are, what we do, all the ministries. Go invite somebody. And if you don't want to invite somebody, look through it yourself, because you will actually learn something about St. John's. I guarantee you. All the stuff that's going on. But share it, okay? Share St. John's with someone. Give them that bag. See, I think what we do here is really special. It isn't like any other church I've been to. We are about following Jesus. Share it. This church makes a difference. It makes a difference in lives. It changes lives. You guys tell me that all the time. So be like Bill. Get excited. Jump up and down if you want. God is good. Now go and share it. Amen. Amen.
Prayers of the People, Form 6, are found on page 392 of the prayer book. In peace we pray to you, Lord God, for all people in their daily life and work,
our families, friends, and neighbors, those who are alone.
For this community, the nation, and the world.
For all who work for justice, freedom, and peace.
For the just and proper use of your creation.
For the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression.
For all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble.
For those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and needy.
For the peace and the unity of the Church of God.
For all who proclaim the gospel and all who seek the truth.
For Catherine, our presiding bishop, and George, our bishop, and for all bishops and other ministers.
For all who serve God and His church.
For the special needs and concerns of this congregation. For Dan Benthrop, Angela Brown, Lon Brown, Tony DeVellington, Nancy Dubler, Trudy Gardner, David Goin, the Reverend Peter Keys, the very Reverend Jim Sanders, Teresa Smith, Nathan Horn, Ron Davis, Mary Catherine Crone, Francis Seiler, Nancy Stiefel, Bob Strickland, Gene Stuckey, John Walker, Betsy Wright, Charles Dunbar, Carrie Ewan, and Ruth Ewald, and Frank Maples. And for those who are in the path of the wildfires, and for the refugees from Syria, we pray for those who are serving our country in the military, especially for those deployed in Afghanistan and Syria, as we pray for the civilians of Afghanistan and for all victims of war. We also pray for the peoples of the Holy Land, as we pray for all people who are being persecuted and displaced because of their faith. Hear us, Lord.
For your mercy is great.
We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life, for the work and ministry of St. John's phone call ministry, for the work and ministry of St. Paul's in Kingsport and Tyson House. The communion anthem is given to the glory of God and in thanksgiving of the service of Betty Bacon to the St. John's Choir. For the flowers in the chapel given to the glory of God in the memory of Hugh and Mary Elizabeth Neal and James and Rosalind Card, and for the flowers in the church given in memory of Elizabeth Lee, McAfee Lee Sr., McAfee Lee Jr., and William Baxter Lee III. Are there others? We will exalt you, O God, our King,
and praise your name forever and ever.
We pray for all those who have died, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. We pray for Jim Hickman, Gabriel Benson, Arthur Wills Lavage III, and George David Weber. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them
who put their trust in you.
We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father.
In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone. And so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in the newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name. Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins, for our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
Please be seated.
We have a moment or two extra today, and I want you to indulge me. So I want you to turn to page 580 of the hymn book, the hymn we just sang. And Jason picks hymnody. I just want to show something to you, if you don't mind. A little teaching moment, but a good moment for us to remind ourselves of St. John's and why we're here. I want you to read stanza 2 if you did not. If you sang it but didn't, we're teaching children reading comprehension. You may have read it. You may have sung it. Maybe you didn't. I don't know. But read stanza 2. Proudly rise our modern city, stately buildings row on row. Yet their windows blank unfeeling stare on canyoned streets below, where the lonely drift unnoticed in the city's ebb and flow, lost a purpose and a meaning, scarcely caring where they go. Tom Raznick and some of you in the staff this morning, this happens this morning. This happens every day. Spent 45 minutes trying to connect a lost young man, probably 2021. If he's here, I apologize for this, probably with a drug addiction, to reconnect to his family, to help him call home, to see if maybe there's a way to restart life. I just simply want to remind you, the things we're singing and praying are real. What we do is real. And that's what, I think that's the energy we're trying to invite you to invite others into. So today, Green Magnet is doing a training after church. They're going to do a training again on, right after church downstairs in the Haslam Room on Wednesday. If you've been so touched and moved, give an hour of your time during the week to read to a child. Maybe that telephone call won't have to be made when they're 21. When they are not reading on grade level by third grade in the school that we're serving, it may not happen at Webb or ESK, but in this school, the odds are they will not graduate. It is real. And the things we're doing are real, and I think they are meaningful, deeply meaningful to you. I am terribly proud of the work that was started all by lay people. Clergy just didn't get to announce it. We take no credit. But if you're touched by it, go downstairs and take a look. If you're touched by it, take the bag today and give it out. That's what we're about. All right, let's stand and exchange the peace. And please, if you will, greet one another with your names. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Ascribe to the Lord the honor to his name, bring offerings and come into his courts.
Make God this world.
Give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give Him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to You, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For by water and the Holy Spirit, You have made us a new people in Jesus Christ our Lord, to show forth Your glory in all the world. Therefore we praise You, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn, to proclaim the glory of Your name.
Holy, holy, holy Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of Your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is He who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy and gracious Father, in Your infinite love, You made us for Yourself, and when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, You, in Your mercy, sent Jesus Christ, Your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to You, the God and Father of all. On the night He was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when He had given thanks to You, He broke it and gave it to His disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is My body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of Me." After supper, He took the cup of wine, and when He had given thanks, He gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is My blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of Me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is God.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling His death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer You these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Taught us, we are bold to say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power and glory, forever and ever. Amen. us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food and the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Amen.
Let's go forth into the world rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Thank you.